Good morning, students. In the previous video, we discussed about the disadvantaged group, which was refugees and IDPs, that is internally displaced persons. In that video, I discussed the definition of IDPs and refugees, and then we discussed the legal protection to IDPs in the international as well as in national perspective. In today's video, I'll discuss first about the legal protection which has been given to refugees at international level, and then we will discuss the rights or legal protections of refugees in the national perspective, and then finally how their rights are violated. At international level, there is UN High Commissioner for Refugee, which was established in 1950. This designation or this position is meant for the protection of refugees all over the world. Then there was Refugee Convention in 1951. This convention provides the rights of refugees internationally. It has codified the rights, documented the rights, and which are available for anyone to refer. Then Refugee Protocol was established in 1967. This was made to ensure that any person who is in need of this particular protocol can exercise the right to seek and take refuge in any other country. It means it is legal to take refuge or asylum or shelter in other country if a person thinks his or her life is in danger in his or her own home country. So that is Refugee Protocol. Then there are three main areas which have been covered in the international perspective or the rights or legal protection which has been given to refugees at international level. These three major points or areas are: first one is the fundamental refugee definition, means who will be considered as a refugee, along with the provision for cessation of and elimination from refugee status, until what time that person will be considered as a refugee, so that we can decide upon till when those rights will be available to those persons. Then second area which has been covered by these perspectives is legal position of refugee in other country, in their country of asylum in which they have taken shelter, their rights and duties in that particular country, including the rights to be guarded against forceful return. If somebody forcefully tell them to return or forcefully tries to get them back to their home country, in that case, what are their rights and who will guard those rights? Or deportation to a country where their lives or freedom would be in jeopardy. Deportation means sending back a person or a refugee to his or her home country where their lives are in risk. Then the third area which is covered is states' obligation and collaboration with UNHCR, the designation which we discussed in the previous slide, in exercising its purposes and administering the appliance of the convention. Means what would the obligation or the points where the states or the country's government need to collaborate with UNHCR while implementing those rights or while administering the implementation of these rights. These three areas have been covered in the legal protection to refugees. Now coming to legal protection of refugees in India. In India, we don't have any specific or separate law to govern rights of refugees, but and also at the same time, we are not even the signatory in Convention of 1951 of the refugees, and also to the Protocol of 1967. So in that sense also, we are not obliged to have any kind of legal protection to the refugees. But in 1995, India became a member of Executive Committee of High Commissioners Program, that is EXCOM. And EXCOM is the organization of UN which approves and supervises the assistance program of UNHCR. UNHCR, which we discussed in previous slides, that is United Nations High Commissioner for Refugee. So what EXCOM do? EXCOM is an organization of UN which helps or assists certain programs of UNHCR. So in that particular sense, we can say that as we are member of EXCOM, so indirectly we are also bound to some of the programs of UNHCR. India voted to adopt UDHR, that is Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which affirms rights of all persons, citizens and non-citizens alike. It means we also, due to being a signatory of UDHR, we also affirm the rights of all persons. Those persons who are either citizens or may not be the citizens. So, refugees who have taken shelter in our country, who are not citizens of our country, still their rights need to be protected, as we are bounded by UDHR to protect the rights of all human beings. Then India also voted affirmatively to adopt UN Declaration of Territorial Asylum in 1967. Then also signed or voted for International Convention on Civil and Political Rights. Then also voted for International Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights in 1976. Another one is UN Convention on Rights of Child in 1989. And Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women in 1974. So, by signing these international declarations or conventions, we indirectly are bound to protect the rights of all human beings. India accepted the principle of non-refoulement. Non-refoulement means protection of refugees from being returned, deportation I already discussed, or expelled to places where their lives or freedoms could be threatened. So, we have already accepted this principle of non-refoulement. That is, we are also against the phenomena of deportation where the refugees are returned or forcefully sent back to their home countries where their lives are at risk. And because of our constitutional provisions also, in which we have provided various kinds of human rights and we are bound to protect them. So, in that sense, indirectly again, we protect the rights of refugees. Now, coming to the last topic, which is violation of rights of refugees and IDPs, how the rights of these two groups, that is refugees and IDPs, are violated. First reason is deprivation of rights due to displacement. In both the scenarios, whether it is refugee or IDP, these people are forced to leave their home place, either outside the national boundaries or within the national boundary, right? So, in this situation, their rights are violated because of these reasons. First is early emergency phase. When they are forced to move from their places, that is the emergency situation. All fundamental rights are violated in situation of emergency. We know in that scenario, everybody only wants to save their lives. So, in that scene, we cannot assume any kind of freedoms or rights to be protected. People have to displace from their homes. Second is the care and maintenance phase, where the government take care or help them in maintaining their lives outside their home places. State is not able to provide them healthy environment, as it is a duty of government, but they are not able to fulfill it up to the standard. Basic facilities need to be provided and care of the displaced people has to be taken by the government, but government many a times fail in that. Then the transitional reintegration phase. After that care and maintenance phase, they need to be rehabilitated, and that is transitional reintegration. We need to reintegrate them. So, that phase is again a major drawback, and in that further rights are violated. Rehabilitation and resettlement becomes a problem. Government is not successful in rehabilitating and resettling the displaced population. Government is not able to provide them employment. They are not able to provide them security and development opportunities. And because of all this, their rights are violated. So, they are not able to live life with dignity. Then is the last phase, that is long-term development phase, in which in long term we assume that government will be able to resettle them, rehabilitate them in the same manner as they were settled in their home places. But in this again, government fails, and because of that, rights of these groups further violated. The movement from stable environment to an unstable environment, earlier they were obviously in a stable environment where they were having education, where they were having employment, every kind of facility was there, but now they have moved to unstable environment. This presents a lot of challenge in front of these people, and for rest of their life they generally keep on fighting with such challenges, as their rights are so much violated that it becomes very difficult for them to go back to their normal lives. Then the second reason is issues of security and protection. In this scenario, obviously their security and protection is a major concern. Security here refers to physical and material safety both. when they are in camps where a security issue arises, obviously they are not safe from the crime, theft, murder, genocide. Deliberate killing of large groups is known as genocide, or rape or torture or forced prostitution or mutilation. Mutilation means serious damage to somebody's physical body, and starvation. These kind of factors make their life miserable. Then the second factor is protection. They are obviously not protected where so much crime is possible, where so much of we could say forced kind of damages are given to them. So in this scenario, they are not at all protected. Protection here means legal protection and personal protection, right? Personal protection already discussed, as these people are not safe. And if we talk about legal protection in case of refugees, this is a problem. In case of IDP, still they are the citizens of the same country, so legal protection is there. But in case of refugees, many of the legal protections are not given to them, as they are not the citizens of that particular country. And freedom from fear and persecution. Generally, refugees have a fear of persecution, as in other country they are thought to be criminals, or they are thought to be some doubtful entities. So in that scenario, these kind of things generally happen with them. These people face discrimination in social as well as legal terms. Obviously, refugees do not get equal rights, equal legal rights as the citizens are getting, and they are not treated well socially as well. This violates their right to equality. These people are subjected to arbitrary arrest and detention. Many a times, because of certain doubts or some other issues in the nearby areas, police generally come and ask them various kind of questions, or maybe even arrest them or detain them in the prisons. Then is the deprivation of right to adequate standard of living, where they are moved. The place is not up to the mark, or we can say is not having an adequate standard of living. Then another right which is violated is right to employment in the new place. It could be difficult for them to get the employment or the chances of livelihood. And next one is deprivation of right to education. Obviously, earlier their kids were used to study in the nearby places, but now as they have moved to new place, this again becomes a challenge, maybe at new place, because of lack of employment, because of poverty, or because of many other factors, the kids may not be able to go or continue their education. Then is the violation of rights of refugees only, right? Here we are discussing violation of rights only for the refugees, not of IDPs. Restrictive measure of government. Every government is not very favorable for the refugees, and they generally take some harsh or restrictive measure, and this affect their right to equality. Government introduced restrictive measures that hamper access to their territory. Means, say for example, they have been restricted to move to certain places. Their movement is only limited to a particular area, that is camp or so. Complicated visa requirements for nationals of some countries, or even fines are imposed on airline that carry undocumented aliens. Then ill treatment. These people are ill treated by many governments. Inappropriate refuge determination procedures. Some governments do not accept them as refugees also. Refoulement, we have already discussed, that is forcefully returning them back to their home countries. Sometimes refoulement takes inhuman forms also, where they are forcibly returned to their home countries. Then threat is always there to their liberties and security, as we have discussed in the previous slides also. Physical assault, sometimes physical assault is also given to them by the government. Detention of asylum seekers for extended period without legitimate reason. There is no legal reason, there is no explanation, still they are detained. And harsh interrogation procedures are followed, and they are not protected at all. And finally, the denial of rights. They are not given freedom, they are not given legal protection, they are not given livelihood opportunities, and the living condition what they are getting is obviously very much degraded. So this is how their rights are violated. That's all about this disadvantaged group. We'll start with the next unit in the next video. Till then, have a good day.